Aloha International.
Am I on?
Yes. I'm really glad you've joined us this morning. My name is Scott, and I'm the lead pastor here, and I'm thrilled that you are with us as well. We are going to continue in our journey of the 38 wonders in one moment. I'm glad the AC's on. That's spooky. We are continuing in 38 wonders, this series we've been in really all year, focusing on the 38 things that happen to a person the moment they put their trust in Jesus, the moment we believe. And there is good news. We are in the home stretch. All right, counting today, we are in single digits. Single digits, baby. 9 more wonders, including today. And as has already been mentioned by Fiona, today we're stepping into kind of a mysterious one to us, and that is this concept of the Trinity. I mean, this might be one of the hardest ones for us to grasp out of all 38, and that is this truth, that the moment you believe, God unites you with the Trinity. The moment you put your faith alone in Christ, you are relationally united with the Father, with the Son, and with the Holy Spirit. Seems pretty straightforward, easy to understand. So we'll just, you know, explain the Trinity, our union with the Trinity, and why it matters in the next, like, half hour or so. Should be good. Just kidding. I'm going to give you some disclaimers up front about our limits on time, our limits of finite human knowledge, as well as just some disclaimers of mystery. But before we dive into this topic, I actually want to start off with a little audience participation, a little bit of a group exercise for you. Here's what I'd like those of you who feel brave enough to try this, here's what I'd like you to do. Give us your metaphor for the Trinity. I want you, if you're willing, to stand up and explain the Trinity to us. Here's the catch. You get 10 seconds. All right, you get 10 seconds. That means one or two sentences to explain the Trinity. Now, most of us usually have to rely on a metaphor or a diagram or something like that. So, nobody's going to laugh at you. This is not to embarrass you. We're all here to learn together, especially such a complex thing like the Trinity. So I want to start off hearing from you. How would you explain the Trinity in 10 seconds? Just raise your hand and I'll call on you. Yes, Debbie.
Ice, water, steam, and liquid.
Yeah. There we go, and water. So.
Water.
The H2O, this analogy that we have H2O, that's the compound in molecule. Is it compound? I don't do science. Thank you, science teacher. Both are correct, one of those. H2O is always H2O, but you'll sometimes see H2O in ice form, in liquid form, or in gas form, but it's always H2O, one thing in three different modes. All right, that's one. I've heard that one before. Maybe you have two. Another one? Yes, Josh.
I heard
it as an egg. Yep. All three parts of one egg. You have one egg, but you got shell, you got egg whites, you got yolk, doing different flavors, different things, but they all make up one egg. It's another good one. Heard that one before, too. Who else? Who's feeling brave? Trevor. Three consciousnesses? Make sure I'm hearing you. Could you give me one more sentence on that? What do you mean? Three consciousnesses melded separately. Inseparably. Three consciousnesses separately. I don't know those words. So you'll have to ask Trevor afterwards to explain that one to you. He's way smarter than I am. So kind of, maybe I've sometimes heard another one of like how you have the human being has understanding, you have a mind and you have a will, kind of all up here, but you know, one person, one brain. So maybe something like that. Yeah, Marvin. Yep. So there's one man, one person, and he may be a son to his parents, maybe a husband to his bride, and a father to his kids, a worker at his job of employment. So you have one person, but kind of fulfilling these different roles. Another one. Anyone? One last one. Throw it out there. Adam. Clover leaf. All right, you got three-leaf clover. It's one plant, one little flower, but you've got three different parts to it that are distinct, yet they all make up the one clover. Those are awesome. Give you another one. Here's one I've used before, is a triangle. You have a triangle. There's one triangle. That is God. And yet that triangle has three points. We have Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And those points are not equal to each other. This point is not that point. It's not that point. So Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are different, but it's one triangle. All right, good. Well, now that we all understand the Trinity, we can move on to the application, right? Thanks, everybody, for explaining this to us. I wish. The truth is that the Trinity is hard to put into words. This is something that's mysterious. It's something that's supernatural. Every analogy, every diagram, every explanation we use for the Trinity will eventually break down at some point. We will end up in heresy, usually modalism or partialism or something like that, by the end of the day if we push our metaphors too far. Now, I do not say that to disparage any of you who just shared. Thank you for sharing. I'm just saying up front, any metaphor I use, you use, we use, that you hear is going to be limited severely. That's because God made nothing exactly like himself in all of creation. He didn't make anything that's exactly like the Trinity. But he did give us, in his word, two of his own metaphors, two analogies that he gave us to kind of start to understand the Trinity. And those two metaphors are marriage and the church. He says that marriage is probably the closest thing you humans are going to get to understanding the Trinity, that you have a man and a woman, 1 + 1 = 1. Two become one flesh. How is that possible? That's bad math. It's mysterious. There is mystery there. What about the church? We are one church body around the whole world. We are one church, and yet we have individual members. And each of us is unique, and we have this multiplicity and individuality, yet we also have unity and cohesion. How does that work? I don't know. It's a bit of a mystery. So to paraphrase a conversation that the apostles had with Jesus, completely out of context, but they said to him one time, "Master, how is this possible?" And Jesus said, with mankind, with humans, it is impossible, but with God, nothing is impossible. So the Trinity, what we're talking about today, is mysterious, but as Professor Daryl Johnson points out, mystery does not mean absurdity. Just because it's hard for it to make sense does not mean that it's nonsense. Some skeptics of this very core Christian doctrine love to point out that, hey, the word Trinity is not even in Scripture. They're correct. It is not in there. You will not find the word Trinity in your Bibles because it is a word that the early church invented to describe the mysterious and real Trinitarian relationship that you see unfolding in Scripture. Some have said that the word Trinity may not be heard in the Bible, but the conversations among the Trinity are absolutely overheard in Scripture. So while it might not be heard, it can be overheard. So let's take some verses. I just want to show you that this is there. Like, this isn't something we're making up on the fly. This isn't a cute little doctrine we're adding to Christianity. This is something God has revealed to us in his word. And I'm going to limit myself to just the Gospel of John. All right, we're just going to look at a few verses in the Gospel of John that kind of demonstrate this point. We'll start off right in John chapter 1, right there at the beginning, the first four verses. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word, capitalized, was with God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him, all things were... Sorry, and the Word was God. Forgot that part. That's a key one, right? Because it's not just with God. The Word was God. The Word was with God in the beginning. Through him, all things were made. Without him, nothing was made that has been made. This Word is the agency for all of creation. All matter that God deals with in creation happens through the agency of the Word, through the, what we'll see here in a second, the Son. In him was life, and the life was the light of all mankind. Jump down to verse 14. That word he's talking about, that word became flesh and made his dwelling among us, Jesus. We have seen the glory, not just his glory, but the glory of the Son and of the Father. He came from the Father full of grace and truth. So there's John's kind of explanation of it in John chapter 1. But we can go to Jesus' own words on this topic. Most of it coming from John 14, but in John 10:30, he says, "The Father and I are one." Somebody sent me a clip one time from a Stephen Colbert show where this one guy was hawking his book, his new book on Jesus, and his big thing is Jesus never actually claimed to be God. And the very first question out of Stephen Colbert's mouth is, John 10:30, "The Father and I are one, continue." Really? Yeah, no, Jesus claimed to be God right there in one sentence. "The Father and I are one." John 14:9, "Anyone who has seen me has seen the Father." Verse 16 and 17, "And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate who will never leave you. He is the Holy Spirit. He leads you into all truth. The world cannot receive him because it isn't looking for him and it doesn't recognize him. But you know him because he lives with you and later will be in you." Verse 23, "All who love me will do what I say. My Father will love them, and we will come and make our home with each of them." So the Holy Spirit's going to live in you, Father's going to live in you, and the Son's going to live in you. Verse 26, "But when the Father sends the Advocate," that's the Holy Spirit, "as my representative," that is the Holy Spirit, "he will teach you everything, will remind you of everything that I have told you." John 15, verse 26, "But I will send you the Advocate." Notice both the Father and the Son are sending the Advocate, the Spirit of truth. "He will come to you from the Father, and he will testify about me." Now, these are just some of the many verses we could have chosen, and these are just from the Gospel of John. You can find these throughout the rest of the Gospels. You can find them throughout the rest of the New Testament. I encourage you to look through the book of Hebrews. There's loads of them. See, the concept of the Trinity is there throughout the Bible. It's even there in the very beginning when God says, "Let us create mankind in our image." Why did he say that? Jewish scholars for a long time thought, well, that was God maybe just using a royal we. Maybe. Or maybe. Throughout the New Testament, he's leaving hints and droplets here that, yes, we believe in monotheism, one God, but this is a unique monotheism. This isn't quite like one God in other cultures and places. Okay, so how can we best define the Trinity without falling off the horse into heresy one way or the other? I think the safest answer and the best answer is to just stick with the Athanasian Creed that was written in the 6th century by the church fathers as a defense against attacks on the Trinity. And one sentence early on in that confession says this: "We worship one God in Trinity and the Trinity in unity, neither blending their persons nor dividing their essence." Okay, what does that mean? It means one God, three persons. One being and three persons within that singular one being. How's that possible? I don't know. I don't know exactly. There is some mystery to all of this, but we can be confident that this is how God has revealed himself to be in Scripture. This is what he says he is like. This is who he is. He is Father, he is Son, and he is Holy Spirit. He has revealed himself to be one God and only one God, not three gods. One God. But as one God, he exists eternally in three persons. They are all equally divine. They all have all the essential attributes of godness, of divinity. All right, so maybe to explain this another way, the Son is fully God. Right, the Son's not missing pieces of God that are essential to being God. The Son is fully God. The Holy Spirit is fully God. He's not missing anything. There's not something lacking. The Father is fully God, and yet the Father is not the Son. The Father is not the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit is not the Son. They are not the same person. They are three persons in one God fully expressed as three persons. That's where I find that the triangle to be the best metaphor I know, because you can kind of picture, okay, there's certain activities that maybe one point is on lead. You know, the Son is the one accomplishing salvation on the cross, but the Father and the Holy Spirit, the other two points are behind him. They're like in support. God is still fully there. When the Holy Spirit's leading as that point of the triangle, the whole triangle's going. The other points are there, but they're in the background. They're in support of the member of the Trinity that's acting in this sense. Again, if we push that to its complete limits, we're going to fall off a cliff. So we don't, but just to help us kind of grasp this a little bit. But that's probably as far as we can go. With the time that we have, with the information we have, there's just limits. However, if this is a topic that interests you, I don't hawk a lot of books, but I would highly recommend this one. It's called The Deep Things of God. Subtitle is How the Trinity Changes Everything by a professor named Fred Sanders, teaches at Talbot University in Los Angeles. Probably maybe my favorite theology book, period, on all of my shelves is this one. How the Trinity Changes Everything. Makes an awesome and compelling case for how the Trinity changes everything and why we stick with it and why it isn't just a peripheral thing in Christianity. Right? Like, this isn't just, okay, well, this is weird. There's kind of those weird things that we have that we believe, but we don't talk about it. No, the Trinity matters much more than that. Church, the Trinity is not a cute or unique little feature of Christianity. The Trinity truly matters. We must accept and believe that God exists perfectly, relationally within himself as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Not three gods operating in three different modes, not one God with three different masks or just three different relationships. Three persons, one God. That's a mystery. He is three and one and one and three all at the same time. But this is not an unimportant topic. This is not just a side thing. God's Trinitarian nature, the fact that he is who he is, that he is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, actually forms the foundation for our faith entirely. You, if you have put your faith in Jesus, you actually already believe this. You might just not realize it yet, how fully you rest on this belief. Everything you and I believe, everything that Scripture teaches, ultimately comes from a foundation of God's Trinitarian nature. Right, the Trinity and the gospel are inseparable. Now, the Trinity is not necessarily something I think that you would have to believe in order to be saved. But even when we start thinking about that, going, well, what's the bare minimum accuracy I need to have? And let's only stick to that. Well, that kind of gets us into trouble. I mean, we want to have maximum accuracy in our understanding of God and how he reveals himself to be. And that's this. If the gospel is the sharp edge of a blade, of a knife that cuts to our hearts, that exposes our sin, then the rest of the metal that makes up the blade, to me, is the Trinity. The Trinity is what supports and makes sense of the gospel, and the handle for understanding all this is God's word. The Trinity and the gospel are inseparable from each other. Let me show you perhaps what I mean. So God exists eternally as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. All right, this is what he has always been from the beginning. He didn't just create and go, oh, hey, I'm gonna make three of myself. He didn't copy himself. This is how he has always been. The Father has been in full and complete relationship with the Son and with the Holy Spirit from the beginning. This has always been that way. Why is that important? It's important for understanding that God has everything he needs right there. God did not create because he was bored. God did not create because he was lonely. God did not create because he needed something from you and me and the rest of creation. What could he possibly need? He has three perfect persons within himself to fully love each other, fully care for one another, fully worship and glorify and live, exist together. This is existence. God needed nothing. Kind of ties in with what we said last week, that God doesn't need us. We actually want to start from that point, that the Trinity is fully satisfied within the perfect community of the Godhead, and it is from that perfection and from that satisfaction that God decides to create. That God decides to say, I want to create. Why? Because he wanted to share with the rest of creation what he already has. He created so that human beings could experience what he experiences from all eternity past and eternity future. Perfect, loving fellowship within himself. He said, I'm too awesome. I need to share this with somebody. I need to create beings who can have a relationship with me and who can enjoy me and be fulfilled in me the way I am fulfilled in myself. Susanna Wesley, who's the mother of the much more famous John Wesley, but Susanna was a very robust theologian in and of her own right, and she penned these words in just her private devotional journal. She's speaking of God, saying he is being itself, and as such, he must necessarily be infinitely happy in the glorious perfections of his nature from everlasting to everlasting. And as he did not create, so he neither did he redeem, because he needed us. But he loved us because he loved us. It's important to understand. When 1 John 4 says that God is love, this is what he's talking about. This is what John means. He has complete love in within himself. He is love. And he wanted us to enjoy what he enjoys. A relationship of perfect love, complete love. You see, the Trinity created so that the Trinity could share the Trinity with creation. That's God's purpose. From beginning to end is to share his glory and his love with all of creation. He created us to have a relationship with us, but our sin got in the way. We rejected him. We rejected this relationship as human beings. Adam and Eve said, no, we're good. We're going to go our own way. We don't need you. And rather than letting us go, fine, you can have your own way. Go away. We've only got three chairs anyway. God said, no, guys, humans, you were created for this. You were created for a relationship with me. Don't walk away. You do not know what you're doing. This is what I have created you to enjoy, is a relationship with me. So the Trinity decided together to act together for the salvation of human beings. What do I mean? I mean in a sense that these persons within the Trinity said, all right, we're going to work together, team, to get humans back. We want to save them from sin, save them from themselves. And we're told in Scripture that God the Father purposed this. He planned salvation from all beginning. In a sense, the Father goes, boys, we're going to open this up. We want to make room for the whole, for people to come into this relationship, to enjoy fellowship within the Trinity. The Son, his role is that he goes, all right, my job is I am sent from God to come to earth to make salvation possible. So again, don't push this metaphor too far, but here's what I'm going to do. It's as if the Son goes to get a chair. Bring it right here and I'm going to sit it next to me, the Son says. I, by my cross, by shedding blood for the sins of the world, by coming back to life and making sinless, holy life possible. Jesus brings the chair to the Trinity. And the Holy Spirit's job, we're told in Scripture, is to call and reach and draw people unto themselves. So the Holy Spirit's job is to come and get you and to bring you into this fellowship with the Trinity. And as we've learned in our time of studying the Holy Spirit, his job is to set you here and put super glue on the chair and keep you here. The Holy Spirit secures you in this fellowship forever. So the Father plans it, the Son is the agent who executes it, and the Holy Spirit is the one who secures it and applies the salvation, applies this relationship to you. The Son has the job of interacting with all of creation, with all material, if you will. Anytime you're in God, which we'll do for eternity, when Jesus came, when we're interacting with the material of God, he took on physical material, we're going to be, that's dealing with the Son. All right, so when it talks in Revelation about God coming down to rule forever, that's the Son. We're not going to see God. He says you can't see God, the Father, sorry, because the Father is Spirit. We're not going to see the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is Spirit. What will you see when you see God is you will see the glorified Son. Now, all interaction that you and I have with God spiritually, all prayer, our spiritual growth, any kind of spiritual connection between us and God is the work of the Holy Spirit. So he does all the physical stuff, the physical act of dying on the cross, the physical act of coming back to life, the physical act of reconciling all creation to himself, Jesus. He's the door for that. And the Holy Spirit does the work of the spiritual renewal, the spiritual application of the gospel in our lives. So can you see that? Can you see how the Trinity together works together to save you and me, to make salvation possible? But the Trinity is not just the source of the gospel. The Trinity isn't just, okay, well, they're the source of the good news, and you have to come. The Trinity actually is the gospel. The Trinity is the good news. When you put your faith in Jesus, this is what you get. This is where all the benefits of salvation are found. This is all the 38 wonders that are yours happen when you sit right here. When you become part of a fellowship, of a union with the Trinity for all times. What you ultimately gain is God himself. The Trinity is not just the source. The Trinity isn't just the means of how we are saved. The Trinity is the goal of what we are saved for. We are saved into and for an eternal, perfect relationship of love that will never end, that God has been enjoying for all creation, and he invites you and me to enjoy. And so the moment you believe in Jesus, you have union with the Trinity. It's as if the Trinity has opened itself up to you and said, come on in. You get to enjoy this. You get to have me. From now until the rest of eternity, you have me. Here's where it gets even cooler, though, church. Union with the Trinity is not just good for salvation. This isn't just how we get saved conceptually. Well, we join this and this is, you know, where holiness and awesomeness is and perfection. This isn't just about saving. This is actually about life. This is about daily living as well as salvation. So we are saved into the Trinity, and everything you and I need for life and godliness we find from union with the Trinity. Because the Holy Spirit is in us, because the Son is with us, and because the Father is for us, we have everything we need for life and godliness right here. This is where all that good stuff is. This isn't just the place we come to receive salvation. This is the place we come to receive life itself. As Susanna Wesley said, he is being. He is existence. He is life itself. This is where the life of humans and the life of God are fused together into one. I know that's mysterious, and I know that's supernatural, but it's true. In his book, Fred Sanders summarizes, he says, Christianity is nothing less than the life of God in the soul of man. That is union with the Trinity. It makes this possible for the life of God to exist in and be lived out in the soul of man. Our salvation and our existence as Christians comes from and consists of the divine union we have here. The life we have with us and God together. This is where salvation comes. This is the door of faith in Christ, is the only way we have access to this relationship. And once we have access to it, once we experience it, this is the place from which our new life is lived. This is the place from which Christianity happens. You won't find it anywhere else. That's why Christianity is not a moral reform program. It's not. It's a come to God, put the life of God into the soul of man, and let him do his thing. Let him transform you and me from the inside out. And this is why, church, the Trinity is not some side doctrine. This is core gospel teaching, that God loves us and has sent the Son to make salvation possible. It's the Holy Spirit who calls us unto him and secures and seals us for all salvation. The Trinity has worked together to save you. You are united with the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Let that sink in. Your name is in that fellowship now. Now, don't misunderstand me. You do not become God, right? The Trinity does not become a quadri-unity. It's not. It stays the Trinity plus you. That relationship will go on for eternity, plus you, plus me, plus the entire church's name right there on that chair. If you've put your faith alone in Christ to save you, you have a relationship with the Father, which is different from your relationship with the Son, and different from your relationship with the Holy Spirit. They are three distinct persons, one being, and you get to be part of it. You are added to, in the middle of this perfect love relationship. So what, you may think? What does that mean? How does this affect my life today? How does this affect me personally? What difference does this make in my life? Professor Daryl Johnson, in his book Experiencing the Trinity, wrote this about the so what question. He says, so what does all this mean for us human beings? It is in this threefold subsistence of love that we live and move and have our being. It is out of that love that God the Father created the world and us in it through the agency of the Son and the energy of the Spirit. It is out of this love that God the Father sent the Son into the world to be born of a virgin by the power of the Spirit. It is out of this love that God the Father handed the Son through the Spirit over to the cross, reconciling the world to himself. It is out of this love relationship right here that God the Father sends the Spirit in the name of the Son to dwell within those that the Son has purchased for the Father. From our creation to our redemption to our glorification, we participate in God's Trinitarian love. From beginning to end, we participate in God's Trinitarian love. We are co-lovers of God with God the moment we have union with him. And one of our great joys as followers of Christ is to figure this out, to learn what this means, and how do we do this, and how do we do this well. But the good news is we have all eternity to figure that out. And even then, we're never going to figure it out because God is infinite. But we get to enjoy this love relationship for all eternity, and it's going to be way better than anything close that we've had. You know, like a marriage. We've been married almost a dozen years with my wife, and I'm still learning new things about her. And she's still learning new things about me. It's going to be that for all eternity with God as we learn what it means to be co-lovers of God with God, what it means to have nothing less than the life of God work itself out in the soul of man for all eternity. And as Christians, we can understand, I think, better than most or maybe others, why relationships going sour hurt so much. Because this is what we were created for. We were created for intimate relationship. Ultimately, with the Trinity. God has designed us from the very beginning to experience a perfect relationship. And we're never going to get there outside of that relationship with him. And our relationship with God is not static. It's not even a singular relationship. You have a Trinitarian relationship with God. You have a threefold relationship with God, with the Father, with the Son, and with the Holy Spirit. Now, I want to put up maybe a little chart that kind of helps us grasp that a little bit. What do I mean when I'm saying that we have three different relationships? There's one God. I love God. And, well, you do. But if you love God accurately, if you love God with full knowledge that is revealed in Scripture, you're going to love him and experience him in a Trinitarian fashion with Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So a list I'm putting up is not exhaustive, but it's just kind of meant to understand this a little bit, kind of tickle the brain a bit here. So if we can put it up, we have the Father, we have the Son, and we have the Holy Spirit. How are they different from each other? How do we relate with them each differently? Well, first you have the Father. Now the Father is the planner. He's the one that, in a sense, is first and foremost in the planning of everything. It says the Father has designed all things in the times that he has set in his planning. But the great news is that the Father, church, is for us. That song that we just sang a bit ago, we have a good, good Father. And our identity comes from the fact that we are now children of God. We have a God who is for us. He is the source of all love. He is the source of all life. Everything comes from him ultimately. And we see God in his relationship with the Son and the Holy Spirit. He sends them both. And you may remember at Jesus' baptism and at his transfiguration on the mountain, where a voice comes from heaven and the Father speaks, "This is my Son whom I love. With him I am well pleased." You have the Father praising the Son for his work. The Son, and because we come to God through the Son, we have a similar relationship. God is for us. God loves you. God speaks over you the same words he speaks over his Son, that you are beloved, that he is well pleased with you. You go, "Scott, he can't be well pleased with me. You don't know what I did this week." And he does. He's still well pleased with you. Not because of what you did this week and not because of what you didn't do this week. He's well pleased with you because of the work of the Son. All right? The relationship that the Son experiences with the Father, we get to experience as well. How's it different from the Son? The Son, in a sense, is within the Trinity. He's the brother that brought us in. He says to his disciples before he leaves, "Hey, I called you friends, but now I'm going to call you brothers." Because there's a different relationship and dynamic that is coming between us and the Son. The Son is God with us. That's what the name Emmanuel means, and you may remember those Christmas songs that I'll talk about. Emmanuel, God with us, has come, as Isaiah promised. That's the Son. The Son is with us at all times next to us. He says in the Great Commission when he sends off his disciples, he says, "Never will I leave you. I will be with you always to the end of the age." So we have God for us in the Father, God with us in the Son. It says that he has come from the Father full of grace and truth. The Son's interaction with you and me is always going to be full of grace and full of truth. Not like 50% grace and 50% truth. 100% truth and 100% grace. As people, we kind of tend to be a little bit more one or the other. We're either like, you know, the truth tellers or we're the gracious people. And often I think in Christianity you have these people that, or even churches that have dynamics of being one or the other, right? Like those are the jerks who just tell you about their sin, and these are the people that never mention sin. Jesus does neither of those. Neither of those. Our limited understanding of how truth and grace works does not apply to him. He is full of both. But as his followers and as his church, we want to try and be full of both. We want to be people who not only speak the truth, but live the truth. And we want to be people who not only speak grace, but live grace with each other and with the world around us. We do that with the Son. That's what he does. The Son worships the Father. He teaches us how to do that. The Son goes, "Hey, Jesus, can you teach us how to pray?" The disciples said. She's like, "Sure. Here's what I want you to say: our Father who is in heaven, our Father." Together we worship and praise the Father. That's what the Son helps us do. That's our relationship with him is different. And then we have the Holy Spirit, whom we've spent 6 weeks on just a few weeks back. If you want to go back and listen to the sermons on YouTube, you can. The Spirit is God in us. Now remember, Jesus said earlier, "Well, I and the Father are also going to come live in you." So it's not like you only have that person in you. You have the whole Trinity in you. But kind of like that triangle idea, there's maybe one person of the Trinity that's in the lead. That's the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the leading the puncture into your life and filling you. The Spirit is where your power comes from. The Spirit is the one who purifies you. Spirit is the one who energizes you to live and experience life as God intended. And the Holy Spirit is going to lead you and me to glorify not just the Father, but also the Son. That's part of his job. He points everything back to the cross, everything back to the Son. You can kind of maybe start to see, okay, I can see how there's the Trinity kind of works together. There's one being, but there is a different relationship you might have with one. We are co-lovers of God with God, Trinitarily. And at International, our goal is that together we aim to help people love God, love people, serve, and engage the world. So the very first thing we want to help you do is love God. And we want to help you do that as accurately and fully as possible, which means not just loving God in some vague sense, but loving God this way, as he is, as he has presented himself to be, not just who we want him to be. Like, this is too complicated, I'm just going to pray and love God. Well, you can. You're free to do that. But I'd encourage you to grow into this mystery. Put deeper roots into this gospel and into the Trinity, not fewer. Don't pull away from this. Lean into this. Maybe even look at that list and you go, man, I am way out of balance here. I've maybe never thought about the Spirit as my brother and how to interact with, or the Jesus, the Son as my brother and how to interact with him. Or, you know, I don't really think about the Spirit and that he provides the source and energy for me. That he's the one who reveals the word to us. That, okay, maybe understanding and interacting with God as he is and how he works. We want to help you love God, and to help you love him fully, we want to help you love him trinitarily. That's why I'm spending so much time on this. To help you grow in your love for God, because that also means growing in our knowledge of him. Understanding who he is. So do you love each member of the Trinity? Are maybe out of balance a little bit here? Is there maybe one member you've ignored, like the weird uncle at the family reunion? Right? You're like, well, we're related, but I don't want to talk to you. That's not God. God wants you to experience the depth and richness of the fellowship and the union that he experiences. He wants you deeper into the Trinity. Come further up, come further in, not less. He wants to have a relationship with each of his three persons. You can be a co-lover of God with God. You get to enjoy him the way he enjoys himself, and we have all of eternity to explore, to understand, and to embrace and discover unique aspects of the Trinity in our union. There is a party. It's maybe a best, I was trying to think of how, what is this experience like? I think it's just a love fest. It's a party that goes on in here that has been going on for all of eternity that God invites you to, right? He's not inviting you to something somber and horrible and terrible. No, this is the best thing that exists in all of creation, himself. That's what you get here. This is a party, and you're invited. You are invited. So what should you do with that invitation? You should join the party. You should come. You should accept his invitation to come into union with himself. Come sit down and experience the gift of union with Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So how do I do that? How do I gain access to this fellowship? How do I sit down on that chair? You simply put your faith alone in Christ alone. It means you recognize and you admit that your sins, by sins, I mean all the things you have ever thought, said, or done that are antithetical to God's holy, perfect nature and decrees. Anything that we've thought, said, or done that goes against God's commands is a sin. We've all sinned. Every single one of us. You, me, all of us. And that sin has separated us from the Trinity. And that's why the Trinity has gone to all this trouble to remove that barrier of sin. That's why Jesus came to die. Because we had this moral problem of sin that created a relational separation between us and him. So he had to come take care of our sin, the atonement on the cross, in order to bring you back into the relationship. That's what Jesus came to do. And if you believe that, if you decide today, I'm going to put my faith in that. I'm going to trust what Jesus has done on the cross, that it paid for my sins. I'm going to trust in his resurrection, that he has come back from the dead and he's brought me back from the dead. The Bible says, then you will be saved. The only path to salvation is to accept what Jesus has done on your behalf. To enter by faith into this mysterious and beautiful three-part party. Join the party. You can do that right where you are this morning. In your mind and in your heart, you can decide to believe this. And if you do, I'd encourage you to tell somebody. It's really good news. We want to celebrate with you. Tell myself or Pastor Dennis or the person who brought you. We would love to first of all, celebrate with you that this is now your life, but also maybe help you, hey, how do I start to live in this fellowship? How do I walk the journey with God? Now, what about those of you who have already joined the party? Here's what you should do. You should enjoy the party. Enjoy the party. This is for you. This is why God created this. He created you and made this possible so you could enjoy him. You could glorify him the way he glorifies himself. You can love and experience him in Trinity. There's a party in there. Go enjoy it. He wants you to. He's created you to. Understand, church, that this is where you belong. This is what you were created for. If you've lived your entire life going, I just don't feel like I belong. I just don't feel like I know what I'm here for. I understand. It's because you were created for this. This is where you belong. This is where there's full acceptance, full love for you. God has planned, he has executed, he has sealed your salvation. You are not here by accident. You are adopted into this family. And I know from families and friends that have adopted kids, sometimes adopted kids can feel like, did you really want me? Do you love me as much as you love your biological children? And as a parent, I know those parents feel, yes, I love you as much, but the adopted kid can always wonder, do I really belong here? And I think sometimes we as believers can feel like, well, we're the fourth odd chair here. Maybe I shouldn't be here. Maybe this isn't for me. Oh, no. No, don't believe those lies. This is for you. This is where you belong. You are loved by the Father as much as the Son. Whatever he feels toward the Son, he feels toward you. Enjoy that. Don't run from it. Enjoy the three relationships. Enjoy the love. Enjoy the acceptance and the joy and the beauty and the love and the purity and the holiness that you get to have in this union. Relish the relationships. You have a Father who is for you. You have a Son who is with you. And you have a Spirit who is in you. Enjoy that. Make use of it. Relate to him as he is. Celebrate this amazing gift that God has given you, that the moment you believed, God united you with the Trinity. You belong at this party. And like all good parties, there's food. God has given us the Son, through the Son, the instructions before he left earth, that, hey, once we actually really get this thing together, when the Son comes back, when he gets rid of all evil, right? He's already conquered sin. He's already conquered death. What still remains is evil. He will purify it all. He will redeem all of creation. He says, we're going to sit down. We're going to eat. There's going to be a party. There's going to be food at this party. And until then, he says, I want you to eat a different meal. And he says, I'm going to refrain from it. He celebrated with his disciples. He said, I'm not going to eat or drink until I get to do it with you guys. There will be food at this party for all of eternity. I think the Italians are probably going to be the chefs in heaven. I sure hope so, at least. Just not the English. Don't make them the chefs. They can be in charge of recreation and sports. When Jesus left, he said, I want you guys to eat. Because when you eat, you'll remember what I have done for you. You'll remember this new covenant, this new relationship that Father, Son, and Holy Spirit have made with you. That's what communion is, the Lord's table. It's an opportunity to think on, reflect on, remember, celebrate that we get to be part of the union with the Trinity. So we're going to do that together as a church this morning. The way that we do it is we pass the elements all the way through the rows. Just take one and wait, and then we'll take it all together with each of the elements. And so if you are a believer here this morning, you say, I've put my trust alone in Christ alone, then this is for you. This is for you to celebrate. This is for you to enjoy the party. So I'm going to invite the deacons up as I pray, and then we'll celebrate communion together as a response to this wonderful news that that's our relationship with God now. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you that you did not abandon us in our sin. That you didn't just break off the relationship as you could have. Lord, you didn't leave us alone, but you decided to work, to sacrifice greatly. Lord, you, the Son, gave up heaven, gave up your throne, Jesus, you came down to earth, took on human flesh. You were born into poverty. You were born on the run with your life being threatened. You've gone through it all, Jesus, for us. And then you take it all the way to the cross, where you, the perfect Son of God, take on all the sins of the world and die on our behalf. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father, for sending the Son. Son, thank you for getting the chair for us. I know it was costly. Carrying that chair was not as easy for you as it was for me just up 3 steps. Lord, it cost you everything. It costs us nothing to accept it. Holy Spirit, thank you that you have called us unto yourself, that you have brought us into this fellowship and into this unity. Thank you for the promise that you are going to keep us there. You have sealed us for all eternity. Lord, we remember what you have done on our behalf right now as we celebrate communion. We ask you to be with us in this time. In Jesus' name, amen.